as Grandmaster's choice. I chose a very interesting, I think, topic, which is 95 sacrifice in Sicilian, mostly Sicilian, because mostly it's in this opening. However, not only, but 95 sacrifice. And this sacrifice is very, very common, and surprisingly, sometimes it's also, I think, a little bit misunderstood. Sometimes people go for it and kind of gamble with it. Sometimes it is simply not good, but very often it is good. So I would like to share pretty much what is my take on this sacrifice. Okay, hello Gil. Still, I think that you know, it is a very good topic to learn about. Various Sicilians, no particular one, various Sicilians, and because it can happen in any primo Sicilian, it can happen in regular Scheveningen, it can happen in Nydorf, can happen, you know, I mean, in many Sicilians. But not only Sicilians, however, I will focus only on Sicilians here. So, the first game I want to talk about is the game between Gadir Gusseinov versus Maxim Adlakov, I think from 2015, was World Cup. So, the position I want to talk about is this one. So, last move White played bishop g3. Let me know, I think it's visible. Yeah, it should be visible. So, yeah, last move was bishop g3. And right now, black could have played simply bishop takes g3, followed by takes on g3 and simply d6 with approximately equal position. There is, you know, not much going on. Both sides have regular, both sides have pieces. Black managed to trade one pair of bishops. And also white knight on f3. Instant usually is not that well placed, I guess. Sometimes it is, but usually it should be better placed, you know, normally ideally on d4. He was kicked out of d4, so it's a success for black. Or maybe on b3, from where it basically supports some maybe a4 ideas and some queenside play. On f3 is also possible, obviously, but it's considered at least with black pawns e6, d6 as a little bit inaccurate, in my opinion. But of course, it's nothing horrible. Position just is simply is around equal. However, in the game falls something different. In the game, Maxim Adlakov played with knight g6. And here I wanted to basically point out one very important detail. We can play possibly knight d5 right away. But the question we have to ask ourselves when we play knight d5 is if knight d5 creates any particular threats right now. If so, does black have to react to this, to this pawn piece sacrifice? Because if white plays knight d5, maybe black can simply play short castle or something like this and just ignore this knight, and this knight will have to retreat. Because the entire idea of playing knight d5 is to somehow get to black's king. And if black can just ignore this knight on d5, well, it may be not such a great idea. So, therefore, a very useful idea for white in general in such positions is to play at first a4. And this is what Gadir Gusseinov played, a4. So the point of a4 is to, first of all, if b takes a4, simply rook takes a4. And we don't need to play we don't need to play knight takes d5. It's not kind of set in stone that knight d5 is must be played in any position, right? To figure out when it's good, when it's not. So a4 is usually very useful because challenges the queen side. And if b takes a4, rook takes a4, white simply accomplishes its goal. And if black plays move b4, right now the queen side is already a little bit weak, and pawn b4 is also sort of vulnerable. And now knight d5 is a little bit different story. Now knight d5 is a very strong. Idea also is to play at some point, maybe in the 1996. Pawn b4 is a weakness right now. Maybe if let's say black doesn't take on this knight on d5, maybe as I said earlier, knight b6 and followed by a5, something like this. We can also start maybe pawn, the pawn on b4. Usually this a4 b4 inclusion is useful for white. So this is what Gadir Gusinov played. And this doesn't threat anything. Well, it does, I think, threat something. Knight b6 actually could be a threat right now. And maybe there is not kind of like obvious threat, but let's say short castle, knight b6 would be already pretty annoying. Same thing was possible here, but let's say if we play knight d5, the point is that I don't know. For instance, I can maybe take here, pawn takes, and in the other position, pawn b4 was hanging already, right? Here is not hanging. Maybe I can play some useful move, like some waiting move, like maybe even just, I don't know, queen to d8, for instance. Not sure if this is the best move, but it's possible. And with idea of playing short castle, knight from d5 very likely will be just kicked out. This is what I'm trying to say. However, in the same position, but if white plays a4 first, before, now let's say, sorry, knight d5, bishop takes g3, hg, well, queen d8 is not possible because knight takes b4 wins the pawn. So there's a big difference. Pawn b4 is also becoming a weakness and possible object of the attack. That's why a4 is useful to start with. So in the game follow, e takes d5, accepting sacrifice. But accepting the sacrifice opens the e file for the rook, and right now black's king is in big trouble. It is this king is in big trouble. Knight d7, logical, trying to hold on to the extra piece. But right now, white has very strong attack. So bishop takes g6, pawn takes g6, and queen d4. And it is pretty white's advantage is pretty much overwhelming. Pawn g7 is hanging. And for instance, king f7 potentially could be met even by. Okay, actually, good. Before I say this, what is probably there are many good moves, but what is one particularly good move after king f7? White to play. Rook d7 followed by queen g7. Yes, this is it. Knight d5 probably is also very strong, but rook d7 is much more direct. And rook d7 simply will be is pretty much the strongest. If bishop b7, of course, bishop takes b8, white wins the queen. And if king takes d7, there is queen g7, and there is no way to protect the rook from on hj because king has to go either here or there. And the game is just won. So this is the simplest. But knight d5, I agree, also is probably very strong. But knight rook e7 is simply much stronger. Okay, so that's why Maxim Malkov played rook g8. But this position is already very bad. Simply knight d5. Now you're checking your move, knight d5. This position is pretty much winning for white. And white, the biggest positive of white's position in general here is that it's very smooth play. Basically, just put throw in more pieces to the attack, and black with such discoordinated pieces like rook on a8, rook on g8, king in the center, white can't hope for anything good here. So in the game, follow queen a7. Now I think the simplest was simply just queen d3. Keep queens on the board, continue the attack. However, Gadir Gusainov with white pieces decided to play queen takes a7, rook takes a7, and now his idea was to play knight c6, which also is sufficient to win. And the game ended with bishop g3, which was an outright blunder. There was still possible resistance with opposite color bishops sometimes, in some lines like d takes c6, bishop d6. Of course, position is very, very bad, but still some maybe hopes. Like practical hope rather than any other, but still, of course, white should win this. So this happened in the game. Rook e7, king f8, and now rook takes d7, and here white won. Maximus Lakoff resigned with black pieces. So this is one of the very good examples how to use knight d5 idea in similar positions, which incidentally occur very often in Sicilian defense. So another example that I wanted to show is a game of Wesley So against Mark Paragua from 2013. So actually we can start from the beginning, because this is all theory for now. So e4, c5, knight f3, d6, d4, c takes d4, knight takes d4, knight f6, knight c3, a6, Nydorf variation in Sicilian. Bishop g5, the sharpest variation, right, in Sicilian, or one of the sharpest. E6, f4. Right now, modern theory obviously suggests move queen b6 or h6, queen b6, going for poison pawn, which leads to extremely complex positions. And this is where the theory pretty much develops here nowadays. However, in this game, also this game was played in 2013, this already then queen b6 was known to be, you know, the key idea, but Mark Paragua decided to play knight bd7. Who wins with most games with black as a GM, that means the most games with black? I don't know, to be honest, but I wouldn't be surprised if this was Magnus Carlsen. So knight bd7, queen f3, queen c7, Longcastle, this is all theory, b5. Bishop d3, bishop b7, rook e1, and now queen b6. This is one of the critical variations in entire bishop g5 variation in Nydorf. So right now white has some choice. However, the most principled variation right now is obviously knight d5. It's the most common, most commonly played, and probably the most challenging, or one of the most challenging options here for white. So here, after knight d5, black has some choice. So e takes d5 or queen takes d4. So if you know the theory, good for you. But try to figure out which one is better. If you don't know the theory here, of course. Because if you know, then you know which move is correct. But if you don't, then maybe tricky, right? Knight d5 is the, again, typical idea here, because all white pieces are just centered and ready for some action, and makes sense to open the center with this piece sacrifice. So anyway, so what would you play right now with black? E takes d5 or queen takes d4? Queen d8, I think queen d8 is a good move. Well, queen d8, I think is not a good move, because it's first of all super passive, and white, I believe, that will somehow crush your defense. You cannot play Nydorf, like, you know, just go backwards queen b8. So we have to accept sacrifice of the knight. Either queen takes d4 or he takes d5. But which one is correct? So take your time, guys. Take on d4. I don't like the knight in the center. Well, both are in the center, right? So a king in the, oh, king in the center, you mean? Okay. Knight takes d5. Knight takes d5 also is possible, but I'll just play e takes d5, I believe, and this position is not so good. Bishop takes d5 also is bad. Bishop basically e takes d5. Yes, I know what you mean. I'm misread. King in the center. You don't like the king in the center. Yes, but queen takes d4 runs into certain issues as well. So let's see. Queen takes d4. What would you do after bishop takes f6? Well, knight f6 doesn't seem, it may seem good, but it's not good. Knight f6 is not good because right now this king is exposed to the struggle for bishop takes b5. And then it discovers the rook to attack the queen, and white wins the queen. So bishop takes b5 will win the game right away. It takes b5, queen rook takes d4. And this is, actually, I guess, rook takes d4, and this is winning for white. So you have to take with the pawn. You have to take with the pawn. And if you take with the pawn, right now again there is bishop takes b5. Knight c7 is not that great because even knight of knight c7, king d8, let's say knight takes a8, king takes a8. Black sort of holds. Black, simplified the position, and actually black doesn't hold. Black is simply better, to be honest, because white has, sorry, black has two minor pieces for the rook. The king is safe in the center suddenly. And white traded all the pieces that sort of created some danger. Even bishop b5, I can just play queen b6, and there is nothing really going on. After takes, takes. Black's king is pretty much safe, and pair of bishops is leaving black with great advantage here. So this knight c7 wouldn't be good, but you can play bishop takes b5. And this is basically where the modern theory develops, because right now the only move is queen c5. And in this position, white has two options. This is basically what modern theory suggests to play with both sides. So right now, there are two moves for white. One is knight takes f6, and this is the old theory, I think. In this line, king d8, knight takes d7, queen takes b5, knight takes f8, rook takes f8, and now very subtle move, queen a3. Long move of the queen towards the queen side to attack the pawn on c6. D6, I mean. King e8, queen takes d6, and now queen c6. And this position is pretty much just unclear. Both sides, have his own chances. It feels to me that black's chances are slightly higher than white's chances, but objectively, of course, white is not worse, and black's king also is in quite a big danger at some point. But there is nothing clear yet. So anyway, position is very complicated. So this is one possibility, and second possibility, this is the modern trend, which of course was begun by modern engines, to play here in this position, not f6 but b4. And after b4, queen b5, knight c7, king e7, knight b5, a takes b5, basically in playing this position, like for instance, queen to d3. Attack pawn d6. So the black plays, let's say, rook a6, support this pawn, rook queen b5, rook b6, and play position like this. Again, extremely crazy stuff, but this is where the modern theory pretty much, one of the lines where the modern theory just develops. But this is where ideas like knight d5 can lead, right? And this is all theory. However, And I mean, anyway, after knight d5, queen d4 is the best move. And the lines we talked about right now are the basically possible replies, that possible courses of the game. But after knight d5, in the game flow, it takes d5. So here, question, how would you play right now with white? How would you play with white here? Yeah. It takes d5 and knight c6. Okay, possible. So, okay, it takes d5. Bishop e7, knight f5. Yeah, after he takes d5, bishop e7, definitely knight f5 is very, very strong. And basically, pawn, the bishop e7 is just lost. e5, also interesting move. e5 is also interesting, and this is actually quite a common idea in this type of position. It takes knight d5, it takes d5 and e5. And I will show one example of this idea. I think there is move bishop e7 or in the right now. And if I'm not mistaken, there white should play queen g3, b4, and now knight d5 as well. This is one of the other lines in Nydorf. It takes d5, and now white plays e5. This is one of the ideas here for white as well. So knight d5, it takes d5, e5. So, and this leads also to some totally crazy stuff. Probably ends by force of a draw, but with computers make everything pretty much drawn, so you cannot argue with the engine, right? So, yeah, but in this position, after he takes d5, e5, it's definitely interesting. But I don't think it's great in this moment because if e5, I'll play simply the pawn takes e5, pawn takes, or maybe even knight e4, maybe even knight e4 if I think about it right now. I'm not. Actually, I would take after e5. Probably I'll just capture, take a knight e4. Yeah, I like this. I like this a little bit more. And I think my knight on e4 is pretty stable. And I still have extra knight. Potentially, I want to play knight takes e5 right now in this position and win this pawn on e5. And maybe also actually take this to queen on take queen d4 at some point as well. And maybe I can consider this too. In general, I think white's initiative here is not as great as it could be. So there is another possibility. So e5 is possible, but is not really working, I think, in this position. But there is one idea that's very, very strong. I can tell you already this. It takes d5 is possible, but it's not the best. It's not the best by far. Can you play like Wesley So? Joachim Klein, start with knight 6. Yes, this is it. Knight to c6 at first. Knight c6 at first. This is the point. Because it's actually a funny move. Because knight c6 leaves this knight on the under under two possible captures, right? But because of the dynamics in the center, and because white pieces are so well developed, and this king is in the center on e8 as well, basically this knight is pretty much untouchable. And white wants to take e takes d5 on the next move. And if d4, let's say, we can again play e5, open it all up. And anyway, white manages to open the position and get to black's king. So knight 6 is a very, very strong move, and this is what Wesley played. Of course, he must have known this idea. I think it's for sure it's still theory. But let me show before we discuss knight 6. Let me show why he takes d5 wouldn't be that great. It wouldn't be that great because after black can play king d8, not bishop e7, because now bishop e7, knight f5, this pin is just deciding the game. So king d8 is not the only move. I mean, in general, in such positions, king tries to run towards the queen side, or ideally to c7, maybe somehow hide there and prove eventually that piece is the extra piece is more relevant, more important than white's initiative that will eventually evaporate. Also, another issue here for white is the pawn on d5 is a weakness. Potentially, black can maybe win it. And with knight c6, now it's a little bit different story than with knight c6 earlier. Right now, black doesn't have to take. And instead, black can play simply king c7, and it's unclear what white will do next. I think the entire attack, entire initiative is just over. So this is pretty much not good here for white. And so I think the bishop f5 is a little bit better try, but after bishop f5, still king c7 leaves black with, let's say, decent survival chances. And as I analyzed, because I analyzed a little bit, I didn't find anything better for white than just taking a draw after queen c3, queen c5, queen a5, queen b6, queen c3. I didn't find anything better than that, and I think the position, the game should be normally end with a draw. Because if black manages to capture pawn on d5 and somehow consolidate the position, you know, white will be down a piece, and this definitely will be, not a good thing. If c4, I would play simply b takes c4, and this is not good either. So yeah, therefore, in this position, white has to play knight to c6 in order to fight for the advantage, and this fight for the advantage should be generally successful. So right now, in the game, Mark Paragua played bishop takes c6, which is a mistake. Which is a mistake that basically decides the game pretty much nearly right away, and we'll see in a moment how. How can you explain Gill's variation? You mean e takes d5, knight c6, d4, e5, right? Bishop takes c6. You mean this? Now I'll take it on f6. Very good question, though. I missed it. Missed this. So e takes f6. Right now I threaten. I give check. And if king here, I don't care about my king queen being under attack, because I make another. I give another discovery check. And this time I'm gonna capture the rook and promote the queen, which is quite funny. And actually, right now I end up being with extra rook. So this is the point. So this is the point. And white wins here. And otherwise, you know, the center just gets open. This game, this king will pretty much get mated. So after knight c6, the game follows bishop takes c6, but this is, I think, losing a mistake as well. So I wanted to show a little bit better defense, which leads to more complications, and gives black some hopes for survival. But objectively, with correct play, white should win as well. But this is better, let's say, resistance. So the best move is takes e4, bishop takes e4, knight c5. And right now, according to my analysis, the best move is bishop takes f6, which perfectly makes sense, because we need to somehow. First of all, our bishop only falls under attack, right? So bishop takes f6 makes sense because, first of all, protects the bishop on e4 and destroys the pawn structure and weakens further the king. So bishop takes f6, g takes f6. And now there are a number of moves that possibly lead to, good chances for white, but by far the strongest choice, I believe, is queen h3. Is this prophylactical move takes control over this diagonal and doesn't allow this king to escape to d7. Doesn't allow this king to escape to to d7. If bishop f5, it's also possible, but I'm a little bit concerned about bishop e, sorry, knight e6, and here we still are under this pin. Let's say bishop takes, let's say pawn takes, rook takes, simply king d7. Well, you need to, in suspension play, be very careful, because even if you play some very natural moves, this may be not the way to go. Because suddenly, how are you gonna defend both pieces, especially with this pin here? So of course it's still very complicated, but I think black is doing well here. I will carefully say that black is doing well here. Maybe not better, but probably not worse either. So that's why the best move, according to my analysis, is queen h3 to take control of this diagonal and basically prepare idea like, for instance, bishop g6. And then that will be just a mate. Right? Because, say, some random move like a5, of course, is a bad move. Let's say bishop g6. And now, even knight e6 will be met by queen e6 with just mate, right? Because this is pinned. So, of course, a5 is a bad move. So, anyway, black plays knight e6. And right now, analyzed further simply again bishop g6. Basically, the same idea, right? And the point is that not only, for instance, after h6, it would be great if this worked for black because queen h8, queen c6, just so much material, right? But with queen on h3, we have additional possibility of rook takes e6. And this basically just mates in three moves. Because f takes e6, queen e6, and it's a mate because king can't go there, right? And if bishop b7, it's just mate in two as well. So, therefore, bishop g6 is a very, very strong move. I should have been in games like this already, so it's not nothing new. But yeah, but anyway, it's very strong. So king d7, again, the best move according to my analysis. Queen c6 perhaps runs into queen e6 and queen f6, and this rook is not also lost. Bishop e4 also is the idea. So this cannot be played. So therefore, king d7, king needs to run. Analyze bishop f7, king e6, queen e6, and in this position, queen d8 I think has been played in some games. And here in some games, queen e3 was the move, and this leads also to very strong composition. But by some reason, computers suggest queen b3, in this position with very, very strong attack. And anyway, this king is very, very weak. It's exposed in the middle of the board. You cannot actually feel that black has extra piece because bishop on f8 is just so passive. Those rooks are disconnected, and white has such a huge dynamic, kind of like initiative, right? That this position for black is very, very risky and scary. However, it's nothing conclusive yet. Still, black can try to somehow defend, but this is pretty much the way to go here with white. Anyway, this was the best chance also for black to somehow hold here. Because after knight c6, if you don't take d takes e4, as we said, right, and takes for the best chance to end this line we talked about. If bishop takes c6, this is what happened in the game. Let's see how the game ended, because the game lasted like maybe 20 moves and it was over. So e takes d5, bishop e7, and now simply e d takes c6. Give king d8. King d8, d takes c6 also is very, very bad because after knight c5, simply c7, for instance, and this discovery for this rook, and white wins. So in the game, follow bishop e7, but anyway, d takes c6. So knight c5. Again, useful to take bishop takes f6 to destroy this pawn structure. G takes f6. And now the point about such position is that white doesn't need to try to go for immediate rook takes e7 threat ideas, like try to checkmate immediately, but we can continue strategic, let's say, play by simply bishop f5. Nothing, not rushing things, simply queen f5, sorry, bishop f5, putting retaining the pressure on the e-file. The king cannot castle anywhere. King is very unsafe, and actually creates a threat of rook takes d6 just to capture pawn d6 just in case. And this position is just over. This position just over. And again, for rook d8, now b4, hitting this knight. Knight a4, simply queen e4, hitting this bishop on e7, queen c7, finally bishop d7, disconnecting, and I rook d7, winning the rook exchange. And again, king is in big, big trouble right now, still not able to castle. Queen a8, queen d8, and now finally, the last move of the game, rook takes e7, which wins here by force. The point is that here, Mark Paraguay resigned. Wesley won, because the point is that okay, queenstone of course not possible because there is a pin, right? So king has to take. Now white plays rook e1. If king evade queen d8, right? So king has to go to d7. Now we can go queen b7. If queen c7, seemingly black is almost there, right? But there is still one move, rook e7, which decides the game. King c7, queen c7, and this is extra queen, and totally winning position for white. So in view of that, after rook takes e7, Mark Paragua resigned and Wesley won. So yes, this was a very, very interesting example, I think, from theoretical perspective. And also, it shows typical ideas in here in Nydorf, how those knights can be sacrificed in those very sensitive squares, like knight d5, knight c6, right? All of this is very interesting, and it's good to know those ideas and how they work in practice. Okay, so very good. Let's go to another game that I prepared, and the next game I wanted to talk about is which to talk about. Let's do probably this one. Yeah, this is a game of Vasily Ivanchuk versus Maxim Vashilograf from 2012 Olympiad. So this was also Nydorf. It happened. Let's start from the beginning. Actually, knight f3, c5. So it was a little bit different move order. But anyway, e4, with transpose back to Sicilian. D6. Maxim Vashilograf, of course, big expert on Nydorf. D4. C takes d4. Knight takes d4. Knight f6. Knight c3. A6. And now bishop g5, again this line, e6, f4. In the previous line we talked about knight b7, right? Here, however, Maxim played move queen c7, which is also possible. Nowadays, Maxim exclusively, I think, plays queen b6 or h6, queen b6. In this game, Maxim played queen c7, which also is a very, very interesting line. I played myself a couple of times with black pieces. Also with white, I played this position a couple of times. So bishop takes f6. The point is here, the point of queen d7 relative to knight d7 is that black tries to postpone knight d7 or play without this move. And let's say after queen c7, queen f3, again delay knight d7 and play b5 instead. After this, for instance, there is move b4, trying to quickly challenge this knight. And again, of course, knight d5 is possible, but you know, at least this knight is on b8 still. And knight, for instance, in this position like this, knight 6 is not such a great deal because we have knight on b8, which covers this square. So, and also we can play maybe bishop b7 followed by short castle, which would pretty much actually we'll just win the game nearly on the spot because there will be no enough compensation. So that's why black tries to save up this tempo on move knight bd7 and to make d5 knight d5 not so great. So even though knight d5 is a typical idea, it may not always work. It may not always work. You have to be very careful when you use it, and always double check, because in chess there is this thing that each position is different, and one idea that works, the same idea that works in one position, in same other position simply may not work. So even though this pattern recognition helps identify the ideas, you still need to check whether those ideas work. That's what I'm trying to say. So in this position, however, in this game, I mean, after queen c7, Vasily Ivanchuk didn't play queen f3, but he simply played bishop takes f6, g takes f6, and queen d2. So this is a more positional approach. A very typical position for for Sicilian Nydorf. And also, I think similar positions, especially after knight c6, arise from Rauser variation in Sicilian. However, Maxim plays in Nydorf style, b5. Now bishop d3. One of many possible moves. I think that objectively long castle is a little bit stronger, but bishop d3 is also very interesting. It's simply a different plan. White wants to go for short castle rather than long castle, and both plans are acceptable. Bishop b7, short castle, knight c6. Knight d7 is usually played whenever white goes long castle. Knight c6 also, but knight c6 also makes sense to try to trade those knights. Now knight to b3, especially if this knight goes to b3, because trading of those knights, let's say queen c6, doesn't necessarily give white anything special. That's why, you know, but white has a little bit more space, so white should try to keep more pieces on the board, and that's why knight b3 has been played. So now h5, typical idea here in Nydorf to play h4, h3. King h1, useful. h4, the value of h3 to weaken the king side. And now Vasily Ivanchuk played h3, of course, trying to make sure this king is safe. Bishop b7, rook e1, typical moves. And now finally b4. So here, this is one of those examples. I will not ask you what would you play, but I will just try to explain what's going on. So this is one of those instances when knight d5, because of course knight d5 is a very, you know, tempting idea. It's a very good idea, to be honest, and it's classic, you know, approach here in this type of position. However, how to put it? Even though it's good, it's not the best. It leads to good position for white. Totally agreed. But it doesn't lead to objectively an advantage. But what it gives, on the other hand, is much easier game. So objectively, for instance, right now, knight a4 is the best move. Or with the idea potentially play simply c3, and you know, it's unclear where this king goes. White has nice center, nice, while it's unclear where black pieces will be ideally placed in the future. This king is, you know, as I said, you know, a little bit not great, if I can put it like that. And white will play c3, open the queen side, try to play slowly and gradually, kind of like, you know, improve the position rather than go for direct measures like knight d5. But knight d5 sacrifices a piece with intent not to win the game pretty much on the spot. Of course, if possible, that would be great. But instead, what knight d5 tries to accomplish is to have easier game, very is a very practical choice, because knight after knight d5, black has to be always on this defensive side, always has to be careful not to blunder something, right? Black has to make deal with this king in the center and this pin on the e-file, and those moves are not really finding for the best moves in such a position is not really really easy. And as we will see, such a very strong player like Maxim Vachon-Lagrave couldn't figure out what to do here exactly, and eventually Ivanchuk won the game. So even though knight a4 or for instance knight d1, similar idea of c3, but knight a4 probably better, is the best, knight d5 is also very interesting. But the idea is not to win right away, but put some very big practical problems to black. So let's see what happened. Knight d5, he takes d5, he takes d5. So right now black has two options, knight a5 or knight a7. Knight b8, knight d8 are very very passive, so knight a7 or knight a5 should be played. So after, and both are possible in the game, followed knight a5, sorry knight a7, but knight a5 also is interesting. But as I checked when I analyzed the game, very likely both approaches will end up with the same position. So let's see what happened in the game. Knight a7. So now, because, you know, earlier we already have played bishop takes f6, g takes f6, right, in move number 7 or whatever it was, right, or 8. Because of that, those pawns are already doubled, and because those pawns are doubled, this creates a very good square for our knight on f5. So what Ivanchuk does, obviously, knight goes to d4. Again, the idea is not to win right away, because it is, you know, difficult to do so if black doesn't blunder anything right away. But the main goal is to have this initiative that will make Black's task, from a practical point of view, very, very difficult. And this is what Ivanchuk managed to accomplish here. Knight d4. So, right now, bishop takes d5. Knight f5. Knight c6. So you can see that the same would have been... sorry, my bad. This was what happened in the game. The same could have been... the same could have happened also after knight a5, right? Because let's say we play right now not knight a7 in this position. Sorry, I jumped a little bit. In this position, not knight a7, but knight a5. You know, pretty much the same thing can happen, right? It's just the same as in the game. So there is not much difference between those moves. However, I believe that bishop takes d5 could be a little bit inaccurate. And the best way to play here with black was to make sure this king is finally out of this e-file. That's why I think the best move was simply king f8, followed by knight f5, and now rook goes to e8. Support this bishop with the rook, improve the piece that hasn't made any moves yet, and make sure this king is safe on f8. Because for now it is. There is no queen on g4 yet, could potentially mate on g7, queen still on d2. So white black has some time to gather forces and solve the problems and hopefully, you know, neutralize the white's initiative and retain extra piece. So rook e8. And after rook e8, white should play rook e3, try to double up on the e-file. Bishop takes d5, rook e1, and now again knight goes to c6. So you can see that very often... Oops, didn't mean to click that. I hope we're back here. Yeah, we are back here. Didn't mean to click that, it was an accident. Knight c6. So after knight c6, basically, you know, we transport the same position no matter if black played knight earlier knight a7 or knight a5, because anyway knight comes back to c6, right? So just the same thing. And right now I believe that black has very good chances to save this. And white needs to be careful not to over push, because it's very easy to be overconfident in such position and suddenly find yourself over pushing and getting being lost. So after knight 6, potentially bishop b5 is the best move, trying to capture this bishop. After this, some computer analysis that I performed, queen takes d5, queen d7, and and basically here black can sort of hold after move like queen takes d6, queen d6 takes, rook e8, king g7, and this endgame finally somehow that should be around drawn. Okay, see some chat. Queen takes b4, bishop a6. I'm not sure where queen b4, bishop a6 and stuff. I'm not sure what they're talking about. Osama. But anyway, here after knight d4, you know, this was pretty much the best try to play because of the spin to go back with this king to f8, knight f5, rook. It was the best defense for black, and the game should eventually become you know, very close to drawn, right, or equal, because, you know, with best defense, of course, it's possible. But the in reality, in when during the practical game, such defense, finding all those moves, like for instance, not just sometimes psychological factors also take play role. This position is psychologically very difficult to play and assess whenever you calculate several moves ahead, right? So those factors also play a role whenever there is some move like this. Instead of bishop b5, why not queen d1 followed by queen g4? Interesting. Let me see. Perhaps I will play simply bishop e6. If you play queen g4, I'm gonna capture your knight. So I assume they only tried to play rook takes e6. But if you play rook takes e6, rook takes pawn takes e6, rook takes e6, then I have I think simply bishop d8, and I don't have you have anything. And that's why I was what I was saying. That it is very easy to overpush in such positions. So you need to also be careful not to, because you know, be careful not to do it, because both positions are not entirely easy to play. It requires, you know, great calculation and understanding of those positions to figure out what you gotta do in them. I hope it makes sense. Bishop e6, right? So let's go back to the game, because the game actually was very interesting. Bishop takes d5 happened, knight f5 obviously, and now knight c6. So I guess Maxime thought, why would I waste time for king f8 rook e8 when I can just capture the pawn d5, play knight c6, maybe ideally bishop e6 even, and play like that simply. So why would I waste time for king f8 when I can capture the pawn? Logical, but again, I can play simply bishop e4. Bishop e4, bishop takes e4, rook takes e4. So white traded both bishops, but idea is right now that with this knight on f5, king always will be in danger, black king, because even goes to evade, the idea of, you know, queen d1, queen g4 right now will be already much stronger than it was earlier, because there will be no bishop e6, right, to challenge this knight on f5. There is nothing that actually can challenge this knight on f5. We can double on the e-file. The spin is very dangerous to black as well. So potentially with correct defense, again, black maybe can hold, but it's very, very dangerous to play. And in the game, Maxime made a mistake and just lost. So it was rook j also good instead of bishop e6. Hold on a second. Let me go back to this line. Rook g8. Possibly, but I'm a little bit worried about queen h5. This is what I didn't like. And I want to go for queen h6. How are you gonna defend from this? Just king. I'll ignore this pawn on g2, but I just want to go for mate with queen h6. If you play bishop to h2, just king h2, you know. No more any more checks, and queen h6 just comes with mate. Rook g6 just queen h8 and mate. Right, so this is not good. And if rook takes g2, rook takes g2, I can presumably play even move like bishop e4. Just to disconnect the rook from the bishop, and you know, I don't know. Looks winning to me for white. I guess you take, then I take, and pretty much the same story. Rook is under attack. How are you gonna defend it? Like rook, I don't know. I think it's just there is no way to save this game here with black. So yeah, that's pretty much it. So finally, let's see what happened in the game. Bishop takes d5. Knight to f5, bishop, sorry, knight c6, and now bishop e4, takes. So, as I was saying, the spin on the e-file is very annoying for black. King on e8 is, of course, in danger, and it's not easy position to play. Even though computers all again say 0-0-0, but you can see that it's very difficult to play such position. Oh, sorry, this is how the game ended, didn't mean to click that. Rook e4, king f8. If d5, for instance, trying to give up the way the pawn, but somehow, you know, make some, bring the pieces up, out, let's say queen d5, rook d8, try to, you know, get pieces out of tempi or something. Still, it doesn't really solve all the problems, because after queen c4, rook d7, even move like, small call move like c3 retains the initiative. It is still dangerous to play this position with black. None of this really solves any of the problems. So in the game for king f8, which is also logical, now he decided to go for rook e8, but this is already a little bit worse version than earlier, Because right now, queen e2, and the same idea of yeah, knight d6 would be great. It would be actually what he, or even queen d6 would be what he would have hoped for. Because right now, probably even rook d8 is good. I think rook d8 is just the key, the winning idea. But even if not rook d8, even queen d6 potentially is just okay for black. But rook d8 I think just wins because there is suddenly this pin. So in the game for queen eight, queen e2, and the idea is of course queen g4, as some of you said in the chat. It was the idea of queen d1, but now queen e2 is the same idea and tripling up on the e-file. So this, you know, two ideas here. Rook h7, logical, queen g4. Rook h7 is logical because queen g4 is a threat anyway, and you have to go then rook h7 no matter what. So rook h7, queen g4. And now I think Maxim made a decisive mistake because he played move d5, and you know, if his move like d5 is a decisive mistake, it means how difficult is the position to play with black. The best move was to play simply queen d7, and after rook e2 play somehow like rook b8, and the idea is again very difficult, rook to b5. And try to hang on here by it's literally a threat. It's like so dangerous and so scary. So here, you know, still black can push with king h2 or something, and after rook b5 knight d7, white has still initiative, white is still better, but this was the only way to not lose right away here with black. In the game, however, play happened, you know, not queen 7 but d5, and d5 is a big mistake because right now this was just with rook b8, rook b5 are not there. After rook e2, queen b6. And now Vasily Ivanchuk played very strong move g3, and after g3, the idea is very simple: just open the g5 for the rook and queen, and you go for checkmate. Knight h6, rook takes h6, just capture. So this does work. But g3 is very strong because right now, you know, I want to go rook g2 and just go for checkmate after opening the g5. So knight d4 followed, but the rest, this is already winning. Let's say if hg, simply queen g3, rook g2 wins. So knight d4 followed, but this allows knight takes d7 on the other hand. And this is winning by force here for white. King d6, rook takes e8. While now material is equal, we got the piece back, but this king is still in danger. Rook on h7 is very exposed. It's just falling, right? And even though this king is a little bit exposed, it is impossible to actually create any danger because white is simply faster to checkmate, right? So after h takes g3, that's what happened in the game. Queen h7, queen f2 was Maxim's idea. And actually, here I think white needs to make, probably just white black wins, right? Yeah, I think just black wins. Because at best, white can hope for a draw only. But of course, rook queen h7 didn't happen. Instead, queen f8 and going after black's king. Rook c8, king d7. If king b5, rook b8. So in the game happened king d7, after queen e8, rook king d6, rook d8, continuous checks. Finally queen e3 from this side, and rook d6 wins the queen, and white won. Alright, so this is pretty much what I wanted to show for today in the for today's Grandmaster's Choice class. I will stop the stream for now, but please don't go anywhere because I'm gonna start within like a minute or two another lecture, which will be games of the week, where I'll talk about some very interesting game or games, depending how much time, how we'll go with time. So don't go anywhere please, and stay on this channel, and I will be back within like a minute or two. I hope this was interesting, so thanks and see you soon.